Today, I have the pleasure of interviewing Dr. Lewis Mehl-Madrona, who is a graduate of Stanford University School of Medicine. He finished his training in family medicine and in psychiatry at the University of Vermont. He is currently Associate Professor of Family Medicine and Psychiatry at the University of Saskatchewan College of Medicine in Canada, and is also Director of their newly evolving Centre for Aboriginal Health and Healing. So welcome to the show, Dr. Mehl-Madrona.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, and why don't you call me Lewis?
Oh, I will. Thank you. Today, we will be talking about the healing power of stories, and I'm wondering, could you tell us a little bit about this and how it affects the health?
Well, there's a movement afoot in the world that links indigenous cultures and modern cultures, which is to see everything as a story. And in the indigenous world, people say that you as a person are the sum total of all the stories that have ever been or ever will be told about you. And so if we think about that, then we want to tell more positive stories than negative stories. So that telling a story, you know, is part of a process in which the story is absorbed by the listener and played back over and over. And so the more healing stories that we tell, the more likely the person is to internalize the message that healing is possible.
Oh, that's wonderful. How has this movement taken hold in the United States?
It's not very popular in the United States. It's much more popular in New Zealand, Australia, South Africa, UK, India. The United States tends to hold on to this idea that there's a truth that science can discover, and there's only one truth, and it's a technologically verifiable truth. And the notion of story is that there's multiple truths, and that many things can be true on different levels without having to be consistent across levels. So the medicine man's story about healing can be as true as the oncologist's story about healing, and that they don't have to be resolved. One doesn't have to be true and the other one false. But here in the U.S., I think it's more common to insist that there's only one correct answer. It's sort of a multiple-choice question culture rather than an essay culture.
Oh, I understand. That's very interesting. But this is spreading, really, isn't it? Because more people are becoming interested in this, aren't they?
That's my impression. And I think if you look at the number of journal articles worldwide that either have the title narrative or indigenous or aboriginal or shamanic, you know, I've seen some graphs that show that it's rising exponentially.
Yes. What do you mean when you talk about narrative medicine?
I mean seeing the illness in the context of all the stories that were ever and could ever be told about the person's life, so that the illness fits within the context of a story.
Yes.
And in medicine, that used to be called the history, but we've lost the art of history taking. And nowadays, we just ask 20 rapid-fire questions and try to fit people quickly into the right slot. And we've also trained people, patients, not to tell the story of their illness, but to wait for those questions. And so by narrative medicine, I mean going back to a very careful listening to the story of the illness and understanding that all of the ideas we could come up for treatment are also just stories.
Mm.
There's stories that can come from traditional Chinese medicine. There's stories that can come from Ayurvedic medicine. There's a story of pharmaceutical medicine.
Yeah.
There's many different stories, the spiritual healing story, the Christian Science story. And what we have to do is match treatment stories to patient stories, that the treatment story has to make sense within the patient and the family's story about what's wrong, or they just won't do it.
Yes, I understand.
And in medicine, we call that non-compliance, but it's really not non-compliance. It's just that we haven't really matched stories. We're not coming from the same place or the same culture as the people that are consulting us.
Do you think that this can be taught now to doctors or healers, practitioners, that there could be some kind of teaching of this storytelling?
I do, and that's, you know, that's a goal of mine, is to teach physicians how to restore the history to medical practice and how to think about everything we do as operating within the context of stories that are unfolding about people's lives and about our lives and about our work and how we see it and how patients see it, so that we can widen our context and we can make healing more possible for more people more of the time.
It's fascinating, actually. What do you mean when you say that a story has a spirit?
In most indigenous cultures, the elders say that when you tell a story, there's some essence of it that's living, you know, that actually enters into the person in the same way that modern culture would think about a virus entering into a person. And they talk about the story actually infecting the person, that it comes into you and that it occupies a part of your world. And I think, in a way, what they mean by that is that once you've heard a story, you know, you don't forget it. I mean, it's always there on some level, and it operates on you. You know, the moral of the story keeps working on you, and the characters of the story stay alive with you. As, like, if you see a really inspiring movie, it's something that stays with you for a long time. And I think that's what the elders mean by that when they say that the story has a spirit. They mean that literally because that's how they think, but we could also interpret it metaphorically in the way that I just mentioned. Or we could think of it in both ways.
Yes, indeed. Now, how do our ancestors continue to communicate with us through traditional stories?
If you look at the traditional stories that are told in indigenous cultures, they support values that promote group survival, sometimes even at individual sacrifice. They promote attitudes of service to the community and service to the group. And so the stories that are ancient and that are told over and over contain within them our ancestors' instructions for how to survive with each other, how to be more concerned with the group than the self, how to put relationship above individual accomplishment, how to care for each other, you know, how men and women should relate, how we should relate to elders, how we should relate to nature. You know, all of these moral instructions are implicit in the ancient teaching stories that are passed on from our ancestors. And I think one of the problems in modern U.S. culture is that these stories, there are no traditional teaching tales. So the problem becomes the wisdom of the ancestors is no longer available to the young people.
I see. So this is what you want to bring back.
Right. That we want to help to connect people into their ancestral stories, whatever those may be. And nowadays, people are multicultural. So there's, you know, many different cultures to draw from for most of us. We're all, instead of being purebreds, we're all sort of mixed up mongrels, so to speak. But we have many cultures that we can draw from. And I think in the same way that we want to preserve biological diversity, that we want to prevent species from disappearing, we also want to preserve cultural diversity. We want to prevent languages and cultures and their stories from disappearing. And so the way to do that is to re-enliven those languages and those cultures and to tell the stories and to learn the language and to practice the culture so that it stays alive in the modern world.
That's why your books are so important. How would medicine change if it recognized the stories that it creates every day?
We would be less arrogant because we would understand that what we've learned isn't the absolute and sole truth, that it's just the truth within a certain worldview, within a kind of biological, genetic worldview, and that there's a lot of other worldviews. There's spiritual worldviews, there's Chinese worldviews, there's Native American worldviews. There are more ways to see health and disease than the one we learned in medical school. Mm-hmm. And so I think if we began to incorporate this, we would be a lot more thoughtful and reflective, and we would be more collaborative with people to come up with approaches to their health and their diseases that make sense to everyone instead of just to us.
Can you tell us a story about a miracle? Perhaps explain what you would make of this story in your daily practice?
Sure. I'm thinking about a man that I met on a reservation who had been in chronic pain for 20 years. And when he began coming to the traditional healer, the traditional healer told him that he needed to tell his pain needed to tell its story, and it needed that the spirit of the pain had to be appreciated and recognized and honored. And so they began to let the pain tell its story, and they, you know, through sweat lodges and through other ceremonies, the pain got to talk. And in fact, they even made it, you know, set up an altar for the pain to come, and a nice little figure for it to spend time in. And slowly but surely, the pain became separate from the man. And the pain took on a personality and identity that became further and further separate from the man. And over the course of about 6 months of working with this healer, the pain essentially disappeared. And the man told me that, he said, you know, prayer is a lot more powerful than drugs. He said, it's too bad that more doctors don't know that. He said, doctors won't ever refer you, you know, to healers. All they want to do is write prescriptions. He said, but the prescriptions just made me sicker. And he said, and then they write you these prescriptions, and then they accuse you of getting addicted to the things that they're writing you to take, and it's just a big mess. And he said, from now on, I'm sticking with the healer. He said, you know, I'm not going back to that crazy world.
Can you give us a traditional story and what use you would make of this?
Sure. Let's see. Let me think of a good story. Okay, there was one that I just told about. I told it to a woman who was having a lot of inflammation. And it was a story about, it was a Diné story from northern Arizona about a first woman inventing rain to put out fires. And this story rests on top of another story, which is about how coyote steals fire so that the people can be warm. But the problem is, when Coyote steals fire, he doesn't actually realize that as he runs down Fire Mountain with fire, that it's setting the whole mountain on aflame. And so by the time he gets the fire to the people, it's burning out of control. And First Woman needs a way to put it out. And so she goes, and this parallels my patient needing a way to calm down and soothe her inflammation. And so she goes to the beaver people and to the animals that live in water, like mink and muskrat and otter, and asks them if they'll divert the water to put out the fire. But they won't, because their homes are safe, because their homes are inside water. And so then she thinks, oh, well, you know, maybe the big strong birds will help me. So she goes to eagle and the hawk and the raptors, but they won't help her either, because they can fly high above the fire. It doesn't bother them. So she's looking around for someone to help her. She goes to spider, and spider shows her how to weave a little basket to put water in, but it doesn't hold enough water to make a difference. And none of the birds really want to carry the water over the mountains anyway. Finally, she goes to Frog, and she says, Frog, your mouth can enlarge enormously. Your people could carry enough water up to the top of the mountain to put this out, if only we can find some birds to take you. And Crane steps forward and says, we'll do it. And so the cranes carry the frogs up above the fire. The frogs let the water go. The water comes down on the fire and puts it out. The steam rises and creates what we now know to be clouds. And the clouds become aware of themselves, because that's how creation is. Whatever is created has awareness and becomes aware of itself. And the clouds turn to First Woman and they say, well, now that you've made us, what are we supposed to do with ourselves?
Yes.
How are we supposed to live? How are we to find meaning for our lives? And she says, you know what? How would you like to be in charge of rain? You can do what Frog did, because it's not practical every time we need water for the cranes to pick up the frogs and carry them up into the sky. Why don't you let the wind blow you to the ocean? You can pick up water for us from the ocean, bring it back, and dump it on the places where people need water, where the land needs to be nourished. And the clouds thought about that, and they said, that sounds wonderful. We'd be happy to do that. We'll be in charge of rain. And that's how it's been even to today, except for those times when clouds pout and refuse to come, which is called a drought.
What an amazing, inspiring story.
It's nice, isn't it?
It's wonderful. Oh, my, you're a great storyteller. I'm going to ask you my last question, which is, what are your plans for the future? I know you're going to be giving a workshop on the 13th to the 15th at Star Visions, and I'll give all the information when we finish the show on that. So what other plans do you have for the future?
Well, I think primarily I'd like to set up an opportunity for people to train and to, you know, come and experience this sort of indigenous-friendly narrative approach to healing, where multiple cultures can interact and people can pick and choose from cultures as they wish, and that we can have a truly cross-cultural experience of health and well-being. And you know, that's probably my most deepest interest is to bring the wisdom of indigenous cultures into the mainstream world in a way that works for everyone.
Thank you, Lewis, so much for being with us today. It's been really, really enjoyable, and I hope you'll come back again.
I'd love to.
And tell us some more stories.
Absolutely, I'd love to do that.
Oh, thank you. Now, for our listeners, Dr. Mehl-Madrona is giving a workshop from the 13th to the 15th of October at Star Visions. For more information on this event, you can email star1897@aol.com. And to read more on Dr. Mehl-Madrona's work, you can visit his websites. You have several websites here, don't you?
I do.
Which one would you like me to give?
Well, I think mehlmadrona.com is probably the best.
Okay. So Mehl-Madrona is spelled MehlMadrona.com. You're also the author of four books, as well as being the editor of a textbook on integrative approaches to anxiety and depression, which I think will be appearing in 2007.
Right.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much again. And this is Merryn Jose, and thank you for listening to MerlianNewsPodcast.com.